Sixth fascinating fact I'd like to tell you, and this is the antiquity of the story of Surya. And the punchline is not there. The punchline is there's an unexpected validation that came just last year, and I'd like to share that with you. So we know the story of Surya, right? So the Rig Veda, Markandeya Purana, Matsya Purana, they're all talking about this. So Sanjana marries Surya, we know that, and they have their children, Yama, Yami, then and so on. One fine day, Surya is so bright that Sanjana can't bear it. So she abandons her husband and goes off to the cooler regions, and she leaves her shadow Chaya in her place. And one fine day, Surya discovers a deception. Hey, you're not my wife. Where is my wife? And she says she's gone to the cooler regions. And cooler regions means southern regions, basically. And so Surya goes off in search of his wife, meaning Surya also has gone to the southern region. He's gone there. And he finds that she's taken the form of a horse. So he too takes the form of a horse. This is shown in this painting over here. And the Ashwini Kumaras are born because of that union at that point. And we have several instances of Ashwinis appearing in the Rig Veda. For example, they appear Ushas. Ushas is the goddess of dawn. So over here in Rig Veda 8.9.17, it says, Ushas, awaken the Ashwinis and start the day. So Ashwinis are appearing at daytime for their share of the Vedic sacrifice, right? That's the intent over here. And we are seeing that they are born in the winter solstice. Why winter solstice? Because Surya goes to the southern region. If Surya goes south, it's winter solstice in the north, right? He's gone to southernmost region. So they appear with the sun at dawn for heliacal rising. So we have to see, when did Ashwini Nakshatra rise along with the sun? When it was winter solstice. That is what we are to do over here. If you crank it back in time, you get a staggering date of 7200 BC. That is when the sun is heliacal rising over here, Ashwini Nakshatra is here, and this turns out to be 7200 BC. This is discovered by Balagangadhar Tilak and repeated by Abhyankar and so on. So I know many of you are uncomfortable looking at this and wondering, what on earth can we have such ancient measurements? After all, Max Müller has told us some things, and NCRT textbooks tell us something else. So can we have had all these things? I got a very, very unexpected validation of this last year from this Nature paper. This Nature paper is talking in 2022, obviously, a cosmogenic radionucleotide revealed an extreme solar particle storm in 9,125 years ago, or approximately 7176 BCE. I put this at 7200 BCE in archaeoastronomy, but this event is 7176 BCE. What are they talking about? By the way, that is not the only paper. A second paper also came in Nature, and this paper is, that earlier one was looking at radioisotopic quantity, radioactive isotopes. This one is looking at tree rings. The tree rings are revealing two strong solar proton events in 7176 and 5259 BCE. That is the second paper in this time frame. So we know that the sun goes through maximum and minimum sunspot activity. Over 11 years, it goes through max min. And whenever there are sunspots, it typically would result in coronal mass ejection, CME events, when sometimes if it comes towards the Earth, it can disrupt the satellite communication and all of those things. We frequently have this kind of events happening. So this is a coronal mass ejection, for example, when a huge solar flare is ejected from the sun, and it might, if you're unlucky, it comes to the Earth, right, towards the Earth. So I wrote something on this, which you can read up on medium.com, once upon a time, 9,000 years ago. The biggest solar event we have known is something called the Carrington Event. This Carrington Event happened in 1859. So the storm was so big, it's the largest solar flare recorded. It resulted in a heavily ionized atmosphere. Basically, when the solar storm hits the Earth, we have got magnetic lines of force, right, around the Earth. So these take the charged particles and conduct them to the North Pole and the South Pole. That be saving the rest of us over here. So what happens is these particles collide with that upper atmosphere, and there are several isotopes and radioactive particles. That's how we get aurora displays, all the auroras in the North Pole and South Pole. That's how we get the northern lights and things of that nature. That's what you see in this animation over here. This resulted in such a heavily ionized atmosphere, telegraph lines could be operated without power. In fact, there is an operator in Portland, Oregon, who was working with this operator in Boston, and they did not turn on the batteries at all. This is 1759. They were doing that Morse code, right? Morse code kind of thing. They could do it without turning on the power. They could operate it. Over a period of 2 days, September 1st, September 2nd, in 1859, this happened. And the coronal displays could be seen in latitude as far south as Hawaii and China. Normally, the northern lights display can only be seen at the polar regions, but this was seen in Hawaii. That tells you how big this event was. So this is one of the biggest events that we know about. And like I said, the solar flare, what happens when it comes, crashes into the Earth, a whole lot of things happen. Billions of tons of super hot gas containing charged particles. So we can detect this because these things go into the North Pole and the South Pole because of the magnetic lines of force. They are preserved in Antarctica as well as the polar ice regions. They preserve the radioactivity. So scientists can go and drill these ice cores and take them to the labs, and they can actually go back in time like a time machine and figure out. This is one example of the ice cores from Antarctica, and scientists are evaluating these things. And in this paper, it says that way back, 7176 BCE, all these graphs, these numbers that you see, suddenly these numbers are shot up. And they say that's one of the biggest ones, maybe 10 times bigger than the Carrington event. That is the estimate. Carrington event is one of the biggest ones that we had today. Scientists today say if the Carrington event happened today, the entire world will lose power for more than 1 year. All the electrical grids will be gone, transformers would have burst, and you wouldn't have so many transformers to replace it. The whole Earth will take 1 year or so to recover. So it's giving you size of that event. This event is said to be 10 times greater than the Carrington event. And all these pictures that you see, I'm not going to describe these isotopes over here, that show a huge jump in 7176 BCE. So what is the relevance of Surya's story? Carrington event was 10 times smaller than 776 BCE. I am saying that the storm could have been observed as increased brilliance of the sun for a period of time. The people who went through Carrington event, they were saying that even at midnight, they could read newspapers and things like that. It was so bright. And if you go to places like Australia and places like that, they said that everywhere we looked, there was brilliance. The lights keep changing, brilliant lights are keep changing and so on. So this kind of an event could have been anywhere you look, the Earth would have been so ionized, you would have seen a brilliance of the sun. Sun would have been super brilliant. Ancient Indians have observed this. 7176, when it happened, Indians have observed this and remembered that sun was super brilliant for a period of time. And after some time, the solar storm subsides, and they have said that Vishwakarma came and chopped off some of sun's brilliance, and then they had marital bliss because Sanjana came back again, right? So that is a story that we remember, but it's pegged to this 7176 BC by two studies, tree rings and ice cores. So what have we done? We have independently derived archaeoastronomy. For the last 100 years, Tilak has been saying this. For the last at least 6 years, I have been saying this. Last year, these two papers came out and provided an independent validation of, yes, there was a solar event that could have been this bright. Our Indians have seen that, have recorded that. So how old is our Purana story now? The story of Surya, how old is it now? So we have got cultural memory going back to 9,000 years, completely opposed to what we have been told in our textbooks and things of this nature.